Today I'll be demonstrating the automatic crystal detection module of the CrystalPro. This is the newest feature to our CrystalPro, one that many of you have in fact asked for. It turns our microscope into a machine vision system. And for those who aren't familiar with the term machine vision, that means the microscope becomes a diagnostic tool of sorts, able to make a determination based on what it sees. So for the CrystalPro, that means the microscope automatically detects the presence of crystals in the wells. To start off, this is the main interface to the CrystalPro. As you can see, you have everything that you'll need right here in front of you. Every function of the microscope is tied to a graphic, whether a button or a menu or a slider. Half of the workspace is devoted to the controls, while the other half is devoted to the video image. First, I'll load a tray onto the CrystalPro stage. The stage has a spring tensioner here to hold the plate securely while it's scanning. Then I'll select the plate template from the definition list. This particular plate is the Art Robbins 3-well IntelliPlate. And I'm going to scan only one of the 3 wells for the sake of time. Now I'll switch to microscope mode so I can investigate the plate and get it ready for scanning. The microscope comes online very quickly, as you can see. It's a USB interface, and now you can see the live video feed from the microscope. Next, I'll click the plate menu and select Scan Plate. Now I just follow the directions. So first, I'll select the folder where the images will be saved. You can pick any folder. I'll go ahead and put it on the desktop here. Next, I'll select which wells to capture. So to select all the wells in the plate, I'll just click on the master select well here in the corner. And now the program checks for available disk space. It confirms that we have enough space to capture these images, so we are ready to begin scanning. So I'll click finish. The CrystalPro starts by moving to the first well, in this case, well A1. The software captures the video information and saves the image to the space we selected. And then the CrystalPro moves on to the next well and captures the next image, and so on and so forth. As you can see, the contact sheet is built image by image during the scan. Each captured image from the camera appears in the main workspace as it's saved. This is your preview image. The acquisition process takes about 6 minutes to capture 96 wells. The image processing takes an additional 4 minutes or so to complete the analysis and flag the images containing crystals. So at this point, we can walk away from the CrystalPro. We can let the microscope do its work. Of course, we're not going to do that right now. Instead, I'll let the instrument continue in real time, and I'll answer a few related questions about what we do and why we do it. Well, number one, a lot of people want to know about the automatic crystal detection module. Unfortunately, I can't tell you exactly how it works. Our patent application is in process, and I can't disclose any technical details yet. But I can tell you that we've designed an illumination scheme that exploits the uniqueness of crystals. Our solution is both hardware and software. The illuminator is contained in this upper module here, and it is compatible with all CrystalPro instruments. For example, if you wanted to upgrade your CrystalPro, we'd replace your illuminator with this one. And we'd upgrade your software to take advantage of the new lighting scheme to automatically detect your crystals in your plates. Basically, we've designed a new lamp that illuminates crystals without the hazardous ultraviolet wavelengths that others are using. Based on the images that the camera captures, the software can differentiate between crystal and clear, or crystal and precipitate. The software processes all the captured images and assigns a probability score to each picture. And that score indicates the likelihood of the presence of a crystal. When the contact sheet is displayed, a color overlay is used to show each score. When this scan is finished, you'll see this overlay, and you'll see how quickly your eye is drawn to the images which contain crystals. Another question that we're asked frequently is, why do we image the plates from underneath? We chose to image sitting drops from underneath to prevent image distortion due to the lens effect of liquid drops. Now, many people don't know that the earliest known lenses date to before recorded history. It's probable that the very first lens was in fact a drop of water or a drop of honey. Imagine dropping a small amount of maple syrup on your morning newspaper or your iPad. Just like that drop of syrup, a protein crystal drop will bend the light rays as they pass through. Now, early on, we chose to allow the light rays that contain no image detail to bend, while preserving the angles and relationship of the light rays that do contain image detail. In other words, we allow the illumination rays to distort instead of the imaging rays. And in fact, our first illuminator uses the curvature of the drop to better see the detail at the edges of the drop. Nobody wants to miss a crystal tucked into the edge. So inverting the microscope, which puts the camera underneath the sitting drop, produces a better image than imaging from above. These are the reasons we recommend an inverted microscope for imaging sitting drops and an upright microscope for imaging hanging drops. The best images are always captured from the flat side of the drop in a plate with a flat bottom. Another question we're asked often is why our prices are so low compared to our competitors. We've been in the microscope manufacturing business for over 20 years. Our overhead is extremely low as we're long past the venture capital stage of growing a business. We've enjoyed years of stability because we meet needs in a variety of markets. Our robotic microscopes are installed all over the world. Our products fit a wide range of applications, from semiconductor manufacturing to detecting invasive species of insects, from quality control of plutonium processing to genetic toxicology, from biohazardous inspection to ballistics fingerprinting. And we listen very carefully to our customers so that we can be sure we're giving them what they need. Our experience designing and building microscopes for so many different people helps us to routinely accomplish what others deem impossible. Our staff holds world-class expertise in nearly every discipline related to this work: software, firmware, mechanical engineering, optical design, electrical engineering, illumination design, and overall design optimization. Typically, what drives cost up the fastest is the outsourcing of tasks. Having such depth to our in-house expertise keeps our prices low. Therefore, it's never necessary to sacrifice quality to reduce cost. Our staff spends a lot of time researching and testing before we announce a new product or feature. What drives us is the science. Our CEO often says, "Profit is the consequence of invention and not the goal." So we work very diligently to validate the efficacy of every feature or product we offer. When we designed our first protein crystal imager in 2001, we did extensive experiments to determine how to best illuminate the drops. We followed August Kohler's example. In the late 1800s, August Kohler designed an illuminator that produced the best image quality and clarity of his day. He taught us that the best microscopic image can only be obtained through the best lighting scheme. We research publications. We perform our own independent experiments. We want to assure ourselves that what we offer is fit for purpose. You know, frankly, in good conscience, we can't offer something that doesn't work. So, sometimes we lose sales opportunities because of popular sales trends that don't reflect good science, as is the case with the ultraviolet hype right now. Logically, if you can see the injection molded tray details in the fluorescence image, does that mean that the plastic tray is fluorescing? Or does that mean that the wavelengths reaching the camera have not been properly filtered? Well, it looks like our scan is finished, and the CrystalPro has begun processing the images. Each image is analyzed and scored automatically. Images that appear to contain crystals will be flagged with a score of 8, according to our scoring criteria here. Images that appear to contain no crystals will be flagged as either a 0, indicating a clear drop, or a 4, indicating precipitate. It looks like we've got a few more minutes until the analysis is complete. Another question that comes up from time to time is, how in the world did we get into the protein crystallography field? Back in 2001, a pharmaceutical company brought us their problem. In fact, most of our products are birthed out of brainstorming solutions for other people's problems. This company needed to see a 10 micron feature in a 1.5 millimeter field of view. Now, they didn't tell us what they were looking at or what they were looking for. So we worked up a proposal for them based on this 10 micron feature specification. They gave us the contract and we went to work. The first thing you need to know about designing a microscope is proper matching of components. You need to know which lenses are going to work well with your camera. You need to know which camera will work best for your sample. A lot of people just pick the camera with the highest number of megapixels. In a lens system, that's absolutely the wrong thing to do. The design is far more complicated than that. Knowing how to match the camera sensor to third-party lenses, it's critical. And for that matter, not all lenses are created equal. Crafting good quality lenses is a fine art, probably more magic than science. Knowing how to match that camera to the lenses in front of it makes all the difference. Knowing which bearings to use, understanding gear ratios, torque, hold current, material flexure, thermal expansion coefficients, it all makes a huge difference in the overall quality and reliability of the instrument. Understanding rolling error and runout error, accounting for bearing non-orthogonality, the list goes on and on. We often tell people there's a lot of technology packed into that little black box. Now, the interesting thing about this is that our customer never told us what they were going to do with our microscope until after we had delivered it. When they showed us our very first protein crystal, they were amazed at the resolution of our microscope. In fact, they were able to see a 6.5 micron crystal in their 1.5 millimeter well. And the best part of all was the day we got the phone call from one of their executives. He thanked us for not overcharging them for the instrument, which he admitted was the standard business practice for selling to pharmaceutical companies. Okay, the image processing is finished, and now we have a colorimetric overlay on our contact sheet. As you can see, it's easy to know which wells we need to concern ourselves with and which ones we don't. The colorimetric overlay draws our attention to the wells with medium to high probabilities of containing crystals. The blue indicates a high probability of crystals, while the red indicates a high probability of clear drops. And you'll even see some of the images that are both red and blue. These overlays indicate a 50% probability of the presence of crystals. Okay, that about wraps up our demo. As you can see, this auto crystal detection module now takes the CrystalPro out of the imager category and into the detector category of instrumentation. If you'd like more information on adding this crystal detector to your lab, send us an email or give us a call. Or if automatically detecting crystals in your tray isn't your thing, tell us what is so we can help you.